so powerful. I walk up here and everybody's quiet. I feel like I should really think of something intelligent to say, so something like that. Well, welcome to the library. We are pleased to see so many of you here, and we are just so heartened by the enthusiastic response we've had to this program. As I think probably most of you know, we had originally just intended to offer this program at 2 o'clock this afternoon, but because of the overwhelming response, we got in touch with the presenters and said, "Hey guys, what do you think? What else could we do?" And they agreed, you know, thought it was a great idea to offer another program, so we're very, very appreciative of that. Today, make sure, please, that your cell phones are turned off. Today we'll be learning about a new Wisconsin public television documentary that profiles the life of Mildred Fish-Harnack, a Wisconsin native and UW-Madison student who became the only American woman executed on direct orders from Adolf Hitler for her role in the Berlin resistance movement. The film was made possible by donations from a variety of individuals and organizations. At today's program, we'd like to especially acknowledge the support provided by the L.E. Phillips Family Foundation. In addition, as I said, the library is very appreciative of Wisconsin Public Television's role in co-sponsoring this program. And at this point, I'd just like to hand the microphone over to Diane Eggins from Public TV, and she has a few words for you.
Thank you, Beth. And I just wanted to say a quick thank you for coming out today. I've been with Wisconsin Public Television for over 25 years, and this has been one of the most exciting projects that we've ever worked on. And it's been a privilege working with Joel, the producer on the show, and all of the other folks at Public Television to make it happen. And you'll hear a lot more about that in a minute. But I also want to say a special thank you to the library for letting us be here today. This is the second time this year in 6 months that we've been here. Actually, we were here last August, and we had a special kids program called Get Up and Go Day all day long, and we fed some video from that into a live broadcast. We had sort of these kids events happening all over the state, and the library hosted us for that last August. We appreciated that, and I think we're coming back again this August, which is what it sounds like, and so that's been terrific. The other exciting thing is Wisconsin Public Television has recently gotten a new remote production truck. So we now can take a crew of 17 people and 6 or 7 cameras out about the state. And we were just really pleased to come and shoot a concert at the State Theater about a year and a half ago, the 5 by Design concert. And so we're looking forward to doing some more shootings of the wonderful performing arts in the area up here, and hope to get back to the UW Jazz Fest here in one of these first couple of years. But just wanted to also say thank you if you're a viewer or a supporter of public television, because your membership makes programs like this and makes, you know, brings all the great stuff that's happening in our communities to people throughout Wisconsin. So thank you so very much for doing that. So. All right, thank you. Beth, thanks again.
You're very welcome. The film that we're going to talk about today, titled Wisconsin's Nazi Resistant, The Mildred Fish-Harnack Story, is available for checkout from the library. There's several copies here at our library, and if you look on the Moore online catalog, you'll see that, at least I think yesterday, there were still a couple copies available. So it's, you can easily get a copy to look at, to check out from the library. You may also view it online anytime at wpt.org/Nazi Resistance. And you don't need to remember that address. Just know that if you Google some of these terms, Mildred Fish-Harnack, Wisconsin Nazi Resistance, Public TV, you will find the link to this 1-hour documentary online quite easily. And you can view it for free online. The DVD is also available for purchase from Wisconsin Public Television. And in addition, you may also request your own copy. I think when you arrived today, you all had a little bookmark. And then you also all had a little card like this. And if you didn't, don't worry, there's more at the back when you leave. But this has all of Diane's contact information on it and information about DVDs that are available to you from Wisconsin Public TV. So if
it's a free copy.
It's a free copy.
I'll send you a free copy. Just let me know if you want this show or some other one listed on the back. My contact information.
Just for sending her mail or calling her, she sends you a DVD. That's pretty nice. So now that I've told you that it's available in all these places for free to watch, or that you can buy your own or get your own, why are we doing this program today? Why did we decide to partner together and put together this program? What's special about today is we have Joel Waldinger with us, who is the producer of this particular documentary. Joel is going to share with us the backstory, how this program was developed, how the film was made, how he got into researching this topic, and give us some insights into what was kept in and what kinds of things they had to choose to keep out. Joel, winner of a National Edward R. Murrow Award and 5 regional Emmys for feature reporting, has recently accepted several awards for this documentary, including the 2012 Best Documentary Award from Northwest Broadcast News Association, the Best Documentary Award from the Wisconsin Broadcasters Association, and the Best Documentary Award from the Milwaukee Press Club. In addition, he's recently been invited to be the keynote speaker and will present the film at the U.S. Embassy's International Teachers Academy in Berlin, and will then tour with the film throughout Germany next September. He's here today to tell us more about his work and about the Mildred Fish-Harnack story. So please join me in welcoming Joel Waldinger.
First of all, I just want to thank you all for coming. The turnout has been amazing. And this is one of the favorite things that I get to do besides doing documentaries. It's talking to all of you and looking at the crowd here today. I need to come to Eau Claire more often, I think. I also wanted to mention some of the other supporters, because truly, at Wisconsin Public Television, if we don't have funding for a project, it doesn't get done. And this is a project that I believed in heart and soul, and I don't want to say I had to fight to get it done, but without the money, it wouldn't have been done. So I want to make sure that we recognize the Francis and Lawrence Weinstein Family Foundation, the Ellie Phillips Family Foundation based here in Eau Claire, Mildred and Mark Connie, the Wisconsin Humanities Council, the funds from the National Endowment for the Humanities, and the Herbert and Elsbeth Weichmann Foundation out of Hamburg, Germany. So again, I really appreciate their support, and I appreciate you coming out today to hear what I have to say and to learn more about this amazing woman who comes from Wisconsin, like so many of us. I first want to ask, how many of you had heard about Mildred Fish-Harnack 5 years ago? Raise your hand. Maybe 5 or so. How many have seen the documentary? About the same number. This story really came to light after the Cold War in 1989, when the two Germanys merged later in the 90s to become one, and KGB files were opened and Stasi German files were opened, and we discovered things in the FBI and CIA files as well. So today I want to talk about this, what I describe as a tragic German-American story. It has good versus evil, Nazis, communists, Cold War, KGB, FBI, CIA, cover-ups, uncoverings, but in the end, it's really a love story. A love for country, a love for humanity, and a love for each other. Because as you'll see, it's love that kept these two together, and it's love that really, in the end, for their love for Germany and the United States, that they died. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to show some clips. There's probably about 4 or 5 clips we're going to show from the documentary. I'm going to set up a little bit about some of the video you'll see, because obviously this is television and not radio, and when you put together an hour-long documentary, it's great to have information, but if you have no video to cover that information with, it becomes radio or newspaper. So there were a lot of obstacles that we had to overcome to try to find some of this stuff. She was born in 1902 in Milwaukee, and at the time it was the most German of American cities. It had a socialist government. in the early 1900s, a socialist government that was born out of German immigrants that had come to this country. German speaking was very common in Milwaukee. There were probably a dozen newspapers that printed in German at the time that she was living there. Her family, however, was extremely poor. Her father couldn't hold down a job, get a teaching degree, but really, as the saying goes, he instead of raised himself up by his bootstraps, he lowered himself. Every job he took, it was one down the ladder. And so they really struggled. Her father died when she was 17, and her mom decided to move to Washington, D.C., where her sister was living. And so that meant Mildred, in her final year of high school, was going to start a new high school in Washington, D.C. She went to a high school, Western High. It was the school of choice for Washington politicians. She went to school with Bob La Follette's daughters. She took the trolley down Wisconsin Avenue to get to school every day. And for Mildred, she couldn't wait to get back to Wisconsin. It was always her dream. She was a Wisconsin girl, and she wanted to come home to Wisconsin. Her two sisters had graduated from the university, and she convinced her mom to give her the opportunity to come back to Wisconsin, and she did do that. So as you watch this clip, notice the black and white films of the university campus. Those are from the 1920s. I was lucky enough to actually stumble across a silent film that was made in the 1920s at the same time Mildred and Arvid were there. So the images that you're seeing are true to what they would have looked like at the time. I had went to the Wisconsin Historical Society when I started researching this, and I wanted to talk to an expert. Tell me what you can about Mildred Fish-Harnack. They had no one who could help me. They had no files on her. They had no information about her. But they did have this silent film, but it was on VHS. VHS wasn't quality high enough for a broadcast. It wrinkles and all that type of thing. So I'm like, well, that won't work. And a few weeks later, I was at the University of Wisconsin Archives, and I talked to their lead archivist, and I said, hey, by chance, do you guys have films in your system? And he said, oh, like six or seven maybe at most. And I said, well, I'm looking for this film onto Wisconsin. Humor me. Go look for it, would you please? And 5 minutes later, he came back with the original film and the original canister. And so that's the film that we use to cover these parts of the story where Mildred meets Arvid on the University of Wisconsin campus.
She arrived in Madison to find a seismic shift in politics. Women now had the right to vote. With dreams of a writing career, Mildred moved into Journalism House. As a student, she worked for the Wisconsin State Journal and joined the Wisconsin Literary Magazine with its Art Deco covers distributed nationwide. Mildred stood out at the university. One professor invited her back to his class, where she impressed students learning Greek.
Entrée des Panaxon.
She memorized the first book of the Iliad in Greek, which is no small feat, and she's recited this, and people that heard her never forgot that.
Mildred Fish would graduate from the University of Wisconsin in the class of 1925. She stayed on as an English instructor during graduate school. Love, life, and lecturing took a dramatic turn when Arvid Harnack, a Rockefeller scholar, arrived from Germany. As the story goes, Arvid went to the wrong building and by mistake ended up in a class taught by Mildred Fish.
He saw this radiant teacher with this blonde hair. Everyone says that Mildred was the most beautiful girl on the university campus. She was absolutely gorgeous. He went up and introduced himself. He apologized for his faltering English, and she apologized that she didn't speak German very well. And he proposed, he studied English with her, and she studied German with him, and that was the beginning of the romance.
A romance sparked by accident or fate soon included canoe rides out to Picnic Point. Mildred and Arvid would talk about their hopes over lunch on Madison State Street. In her memoirs, Arvid's sister Inga described what happened next.
I still remember how a letter arrived from my mother with a laconic sentence, I've met a girl with a beautiful name, Mildred. My mother read it and said with assertiveness, that's her, meaning that will be his wife.
The invitations went out announcing an August 7th wedding. Always an independent thinker, Mildred Fish-Harnack chose to hyphenate her married name.
She married into an elite family, in an academic sense. Almost everybody excelled at whatever it was they did, in one way or another.
Arvid's father, Otto Harnack,
was a noted literary historian. Like Mildred, Arvid lost his father at a young age and grew up under the strong guidance of his mother.
He was a very gifted child. He wrote poems, he painted, he wrote dramas. Later, he became the so-called streng, serious and analytic mind.
Arvid's mind would be challenged at the University of Wisconsin by John R. Commons, a well-known professor of economics. It was at Professor Commons' house where Arvid and Mildred would gather with a circle of friends to discuss social, economic, and political policy.
These were very progressive people that were, in fact, inventing very significant legislation. Unemployment insurance, workmen's compensation, Social Security. These people were the heart of the progressive movement and the Wisconsin idea.
These students became known as the Friday Nighters and included another German student named Greta Kukoff.
The University of Wisconsin in Madison played an absolutely unique role in creating the intellectual outlook of this group. Arvid and Mildred Harnack, Greta Kukoff, all had a formation here.
And what they learned in Madison was about to be tested in a fight against the Nazis.
So what did they learn in Madison? Well, Mildred knew Greek, French, Latin, German, and English. She used those language skills to translate speeches by Winston Churchill and Roosevelt at the time. And they published what was considered an underground newspaper in Berlin. A lot of those went to foreign slave laborers. But basically, it was messages from the outside world that were banned in Nazi Germany at the time. Those speeches couldn't be heard, and a lot of people would put their radio underneath their rug and put their head over the radio to listen to these outside speeches. So Mildred did that. Greta Kukoff, the other German student who had come to the university and met up with Arvid and Mildred, she was a translator by profession when she went back to Germany. And while she was working in the resistance, her main job was to translate Mein Kampf, Hitler's autobiography, into English. So not only was she working against him, but she was also translating his work into English. Mildred, they wrote for the Wisconsin State Journal. I was told originally there were no bylines for her, that you wouldn't find any articles of hers. And I actually did a story for the Wisconsin State Journal where they were interviewing me about this story, and I told the reporter that. And he got in touch with their archives, and lo and behold, they were able to find three articles that Mildred had written with her bylines. She originally was the kind of the social writer for the newspaper. And on Monday, June 12, 1922, she wrote, "A house party at Tech's Lodge on Lake Mendota over the weekend was chaperoned by Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Brittingham, Jr., who motored to Madison from Riverside, Illinois. Mrs. Helen Brannon of Chicago and Mrs. Helen McCarthy were included in the party." So that was her writing initially. 3 months later, she was promoted to more serious topics. And she ended up getting a front page article. She wrote in September of 1922 about Professor E.A. Ross's trip to Mexico about the Mexican labor movement. And as I mentioned, it was front page news. Arvid was here to study the American labor movement. He was a Rockefeller scholar, one of only three out of Germany in that year. They would hitchhike around the Midwest. Mildred would dress as a man because it wasn't safe to hitchhike. And so she wore slacks and a shirt and a hat. And we know for sure that they went to a meeting in Colorado of the Industrial Workers of the World, a left-leaning union at the time. Arvid's thesis was on the pre-Marxist labor movement in the United States. He was interested in that movement, and he came here because of Professor Commons and what was happening with labor issues at that time in the United States, and specifically in Wisconsin. So they were taking these trips around the United States, and Arvid had to go home, and he didn't have enough money to support Mildred, but 6 months after they met, they were married. So Mildred took a teaching job on the East Coast at Goucher College, and used that when she actually did end up joining Arvid in Germany a year later. She went back to school, as all the Harnacks did. They were all professors and scholars and Nobel Peace Prize winners and that type of thing. So she really did marry into an elite family. She arrives in Berlin in 1931. She became one of the first Americans to be hired at Berlin University at the time. She taught modern American literature. She taught it in English. And she was on the faculty with Albert Einstein. So that shows you how prestigious of the school it was. But not only was she on the faculty with him, he came to listen to her lectures. There's proof that he was very interested in what she was teaching about in the American way. She was well known in Berlin. She was president of the American Women's Club. She was secretary for the Daughters of the American Revolution. She lectured at the American Church, and this is where Albert Einstein would come and listen to her. It was not only a social circle for Americans, but the American Church invited people in from all different points of view to come and lecture, and then people could come and listen to her, and eventually she had to stop because the Nazis were sending people there to listen to what she was talking about, which went over well at the time in Germany. She was also well connected to Ambassador Dodd's daughter, Martha Dodd. How many of you have heard of Eric Larson's book, In the Garden of Beasts? It was on the New York bestseller list about a year or so ago. She's mentioned several times in there. There's one bit of information that we'll get into a bit later that Eric got wrong, unfortunately. It's a good book, don't get me wrong, but Arvid's brother repeated a fact after the war that wasn't true, and unfortunately it's lived to this day, and part of it was that she was forced to watch her husband's execution, and I will show you the proof that I have that that didn't happen a little bit later. But Mildred also left a trail of writings and information about her life. She was a scholar, and so when she taught in Berlin, she often wrote about life here in Wisconsin, which for a researcher was really great if you know her story. And let me give you an example. She wrote one story about a gentleman that came and met this woman. They went on a first date. They took a canoe ride out to Picnic Point. He tried to kiss her. She refused. She was just out of a relationship herself. They got sun-drenched on the rocks of Picnic Point that day, and he walked her home that night, gave her a bunch of flowers, and she laid in her bed and couldn't fall asleep thinking of this guy from the Baltic that the woman she was renting the room from said, you know, those men from the Baltic make great husbands. And there was a pebble knock on the window. She opened the window and there was Arvid standing in the moonlight. But in the story, the guy's name isn't Arvid, it's Rudolf. Arvid's middle name is Rudolf. So if you know the story, you can follow kind of the breadcrumbs that she left behind about her life. And there were lots of incidents like that. Another great find was letters that she had written home to her mother, talking about the change in power in Germany in 1933 when Hitler came to be chancellor. She wrote this letter home Saturday, October 18th, 1930. So this was right after the elections. The elections were disturbing, as you noticed. The group names itself the National Socialist, although it has nothing to do with socialism, and the name itself is a lie. It thinks itself highly moral, and like the Ku Klux Klan, makes a campaign of hatred against Jews. Now, her reference to the KKK is really interesting because in 1924, when she was on the UW campus, more than 2,000 members of the KKK marched down King Street in Madison. Their aim was to clean up Madison's troubled Greenbush neighborhood, home to Jews, Italians, immigrants, minorities, as were Mildred Fish-Harnack lived as well. In February 1933, 70 years ago this month, she wrote home to her mother saying, "Think about my last letter. I fear it may have frightened you." Well, it should not. Our curious ideas are not known here. We are not active politically. We are safe, very well, and happy. If anyone asks you about us, we are not interested in the world from a political, but from a scientific standpoint. That's all you need to say. You see, we are harmless and quiet people. What happened with Mildred's letters over time is she started writing the opposite of what she meant. So you heard the first letter after the election saying that this was not a good thing and they wouldn't stand to be. And the Harnacks believed that this was going to be short-lived, that Hitler was not going to stay in power very long. Like many Germans, they were fooled. But one thing they did do when they came to Germany that they also did in Madison is they had what's called a salon, where they would invite friends over, they would read Shakespeare, they would talk about current events, and things happening in the world. And here in Madison, one of the members of this progressive group was Frank Lloyd Wright. So when they went to Berlin, they decided they were to continue doing this with their friends, including Greta Kuhkoff, that UW student from Germany who was translating Mein Kampf, her and her husband were part of the group. And after a while, when they were seeing what was happening on the world stage, this group transformed from a social network of maybe 7 or 8 people into the resistance. They couldn't stand by idly anymore and do nothing. On May 2nd, 1933, she wrote home again. writing the opposite of what she meant. Yesterday, there was an enormous May Day celebration here. How beautiful it was. They mobilized millions, and with an exultant feeling of loving and being loved by their country, there is a great impulse in the masses of people which can be roused, a very great and beautiful impulse. You know that I thought this impulse was directed rightly versus the Jews and radicals, etc., especially those connected to Russia. Well, it is very beautiful, serious thing, serious as death, and I hope it will never be perverted again. Think this over, for I want you to understand me. So from her letters, again, we know what she was doing. She wrote her mother almost weekly. These letters were discovered in an attic of her sister's house in the mid-1990s, is when this information started to come out. We also know that Mildred and Arvid's fight against the Nazis was very personal. Arvid's sister Inga, who was Mildred's best friend, was married to a Jew, and they had two sons. One of those sons was forced into the military and died at age 18. He was killed by the Americans. The husband fled to France and then initially to London, and the son caught up with him later, but they were so traumatized as to what had happened during the war that they changed their names and really didn't talk about it the rest of their life. We know also that Mildred helped her Jewish friends. There's reports that she helped smuggle some diamonds out for a Jewish family. We know that she was working for a publishing company and had access to travel around Europe. And during that access, she was gathering documents to help get other Jews out of the country. We know she had contacts at the U.S. Embassy, which would have come in very handy as well, to get those documents and to get people out. What we don't have is a list of, oh, she helped 15 people, or 30 people, or 50 people, or 100 people. We simply don't know. They didn't keep track of that kind of stuff, obviously, for security reasons. But we do know that there was a famous writer named Max Tao, who was Jewish, who talks about Mildred helping him escape. Again, we just don't know exactly how that happened. In 1932, Arvid, interested in the labor movement, was interested in what was happening with the Soviet planned economy. Things in the United States weren't going real well at that time. The economy was bad, the stock market crashed, all of these things were happening, but he was really interested in this plan that was experimental in the Soviet Union at the time. And he formed a study group to study this Soviet economy, and he took his first trip to the Soviet Union in 1932, and it's believed that that's when Soviet intelligence first got in contact with him. They were interested in any economic information that he could provide to them. Mildred also traveled to the Soviet Union. We know for sure at least one time, possibly two times, the second time, if she did go, she went through third countries. It wasn't directly from Germany to Russia at the time. And Mildred was really interested in what was happening in Russia at the time. She was interested in films and books and everything else that she could read there. And her family thought that she was extremely radical coming out of Madison, radical city, and these radical thoughts that she had, and now she's looking to the Soviet Union and all of their radical thoughts. Well, what were their radical thoughts that she really embraced? Well, one was equal pay for women. That's pretty radical. Child support payments, education about birth control, maternity leave for women. It was women's issues that really drew her to what was happening in the Soviet Union at that time, or Russia. And, you know, we look at that today, and we look back and think, okay, the communists were so far ahead of us on those issues, at least, and this is what she really embraced, is these women's issues. As far as the resistance work, they were also supplying the Americans with information. Arvid worked in the Treasury Department. At the time, the U.S. ambassador, Dodd, had already left Germany when Arvid was contacted by Donald Heath, who was the first secretary, the highest-ranking official left at the U.S. Embassy. And he was working for British intelligence as well as the United States, and his mission was to get financial information from Germany about their buildup for the war. And of course, Arvid was sitting on the American desk in the finance department, and he had access to all this information. So the two families actually became very good friends. Mildred tutored the son, who was 11 years old. They pulled him out of German schools because they didn't like what the Nazis were teaching him at that time, and they wanted him to have an American education. Mildred was a teacher without work because she wasn't Nazi enough, so she got fired from her teaching job. And she would teach this boy, who would be the courier of information that Arvid would get from work. They would give it to the boy, and the boy would take it to his father. It was dangerous for the two families to meet a lot, but once in a while, they would go out on a weekend, maybe 20 miles outside of Berlin, and meet, or at a rural lake or something like that, the two families would meet, and they did become very good friends. And that boy is the only living survivor that I was able to talk to about Mildred. It took me 12 hours of talking to him on the phone over the course of three nights to get him to agree to talk to me. part of the reason was, and the family was very leery too, because this story has been so twisted through time, and these people have not been treated very well through history. And they were leery of, okay, who's this next guy to come along to twist this story? So it took a lot of convincing, but Donald Heath Jr. initially didn't want to talk, and then he did agree to talk. So they supplied the Soviets with military information. They warned Stalin 10 months before the invasion of the Soviet Union. You know, the Germans and the Russians had a pact that the Germans weren't going to invade. This group knew, because of their high-ranking military officials, that that was not the case. There was a buildup of military hardware on the border. There were flyovers of the Soviet territory. And they were warning Stalin of that, but he didn't believe it. In fact, he had a few choice words for them and really wanted them executed. So the Soviets acted not on the information at all, and the Americans didn't know what to do with the information that was coming from Arvid. He was never listed by name in any of this information. It was always a high-ranking German official within the finance department. But if you know, again, the story and the trail, you can track down what information he was supplying. The Soviets wanted to get back in touch with them. Stalin kept sending agents to Berlin to work with the Harnacks and the resistance group, and then he would call them back to Russia and have those agents executed. So it was just this revolving door of people that were working with the Harnacks. They finally lost touch, and then the Soviets said, you know, we need to get back in touch with that group. They had code names. Arvid was Corsican, and the other military leader was Starshina. And they always used these code names. They never used their real names. Except when the Soviets wanted to get in touch with them again. They contacted their agents in Brussels, and they said, in code, will you go to find these people? They gave three names. One of them was Mildred and Arvid Harnack, and their address. So a year later, the Germans deciphered the code, and the group was busted. So it was a Soviet blunder that really caused this group to be arrested. The first member was arrested on August 31st, and Mildred and Arvid were arrested on August 7th. It's believed that they were trying to escape to Sweden, that they had been tipped off. These arrests were happening. They agreed to take a vacation with close family friends to Pryl, which is in current-day Lithuania. And the night before their arrest, Arvid had asked what it would take to get a boat to Sweden. We know that they had some contacts in Sweden as well. And unfortunately, that didn't happen. The Gestapo came in and arrested them, and they were taken back to Berlin. And that's what this next clip picks up.
The secret police brought the Harnacks to one of the most feared addresses in the German capital, Gestapo headquarters. Walter Habecker, known for his brutal torture techniques, was assigned to break the Harnacks.
We know that in the case of the men, including Arvid Harnack, there were extreme forms of torture.
Mildred was incarcerated at a Charlottenburg women's prison and taken daily for questioning. Other resistance fighters, including Helmut Roloff, overheard Mildred's interrogations.
And this day that my father had that brief view of her, he was sitting in front of the interrogation room, and he heard a terrible, terrible amount of screaming and yelling inside of that room. And Mildred must have had a breakdown because she was brought out on a stretcher.
More than 100 Germans had been arrested. Their resistance network stunned the Nazis. These were Germans who could have benefited from the regime.
Hitler was shocked. Hitler thought he had the entire nation behind himself. He was sure of that. And when he saw the diversity of this group, the oldest person arrested was 86 years old, the youngest was 16, 40% women, every walk of life.
3 weeks after the Harnack's arrest, Arvid's cousin Axel von Harnack was summoned to Gestapo headquarters. Axel later wrote about his ordeal.
I was told it concerned a very serious matter, and the whole thing must remain absolutely secret. I was to explain their absence as an official trip to foreign countries of indefinite duration.
It was too dangerous to get anybody else from the family being involved. If they can't get you, the Gestapo, they get the family. And Sippenhaft is something like a collective punishment of the family members.
The Harnack relatives took the risk.
Dr. Falk Harnack, the younger brother of the prisoner, had come to Berlin several times. He alone had been permitted to speak to his brother twice. No one ever received permission to speak with Mrs. Harnack.
Mildred did manage to get one note to Arvid's family.
Dear Axel, Mother, and Falk, thank you a thousand times for everything you are doing for me. Many greetings and kisses, Mildred.
Arvid's mother replied,
not a day passes that we don't think of you and your beloved Arvid time and again. I don't know what you have done, but I'm quite certain that you could not do anything from selfish, base motives, dear Mildred.
During its investigation, the Gestapo labeled the resistance network the Rote Kapelle, or Red Orchestra, Red being a communist moniker.
The Gestapo only linked the group to the Soviet Union, but the Gestapo has no idea that Arvid Mildred also has close contacts to members of the United States Embassy here in Berlin.
Arvid Harnack was not going to admit he passed on information to the Americans. Why would he do that? They were not going to admit that since it was illegal to get Jews out of the country, they were not going to say, well, yeah, and by the way, we helped a number of Jews escape.
The trials began in December 1942 at the highest military court where justice wasn't blind, and a death sentence was almost assured.
An Air Force prosecutor named Manfred Röder was called Hitler's bloodhound, and he even shocked the military judges with how bloodthirsty he was in demanding the death sentence for every possible case.
The trials, shrouded in secrecy, often family members weren't even told.
The entire process was a joke, a very bad, tragic joke. In many cases, they met with their lawyers for 5 minutes before they were tried. Mildred and Arvid Harnack were tried early on. It was pretty clear that they were going to be dealt with harshly.
Arvid would be sentenced to death for high treason and espionage. The defense would argue Mildred simply acted on her husband's orders. Mildred's sentence? 6 years in prison. With the help of eyewitnesses, Arvid's cousin documented what happened next.
Dr. Harnack, looking straight at his wife, was radiant. He insisted that because of that sentence, her life had been saved, for she would be able to serve that term or even surely be liberated before them.
Arvid's sister, Inga, waited outside to get details for the family.
My dear Mama, the court martial pronounced the cruel verdict. Although we all secretly expected it, it was still a blow. I want to urge you again not to give up hope.
2 days later, Hitler personally signed Arvid's death sentence. The night before his execution, Arvid wrote a farewell letter.
Within the next hours, I will depart this life. I would like to thank you all again for all your love which you have shown me. So, I am calm and happy. Tonight, I will hold a small pre-Christmas celebration, and I will read aloud the Christmas story. And then comes the moment of departing. Your Arvid.
The next day, Arvid was handcuffed and taken into a small building at Plötzensee prison. The prosecutor, Manfred Röder, witnessed the special punishment Hitler had ordered.
He decided to have these meat hooks put up in Plötzensee at the prison.
Overhead, the newly installed meat hooks, Arvid would hang by a short rope, a Nazi torture tactic to prolong his suffering.
It was a private revenge of Hitler against these people.
Arvid's petition to see Mildred one last time had been denied. Arvid went to his death not knowing Hitler refused to sign Mildred's prison sentence and had ordered a retrial.
I think that the rage drove a thirst for vengeance that Hitler felt personally.
He wanted this American woman. He didn't want any martyrs. He wanted her dead.
So a couple of things I wanted to point out, and that is, one, there's Arvid smiling after the original sentence of 6 years in prison, and there was a specific reason why he was smiling. Arvid had members of his family that were also involved in the July 20th plot to assassinate Hitler. If any of you have seen the Tom Cruise movie Valkyrie, that's what that movie is about. Arvid had seven members of his family that were involved in the resistance, including Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the Lutheran theologian, who was studying in this country and went back to Germany to fight for what he believed in and ended up being executed 2 weeks before the end of the war. But also involved in that July 20th plot was a military leader by the name of Klaus von Stauffenberg. One of the homes where the Harnacks lived on the outskirts of Berlin, they had moved out there to get kind of away from the eavesdropping of the Gestapo, was approximately five or six houses away from where Klaus von Stauffenberg lived. We know that Arvid was aware of this plot, and so when he heard that Mildred was going to be sentenced to 6 years in prison, they knew this plot was going to happen. He thought the war would end sooner than that, and that she would survive to see a free Germany. So that was what his reaction was to her original sentencing. The video you just saw of Charlottenburg Women's Prison, that's the huge brick building where Mildred was housed, there's no records of her being held there. These arrests were so top secret that they didn't even list where she was being held in prison, so the families couldn't find where she was either. Her and another woman, one of the other military leaders' wives, were held there. And the reason that we know Mildred was at that prison is a prisoner after the war said that there was this one prisoner who was isolated, and she always had to walk in the middle when they would take them off to the courtyard for 15 minutes. Most of the women were in pairs, and they would walk around the perimeter inside the prison. Mildred had to walk back and forth across the middle and was not allowed to talk to anybody. She was also held in isolation. But one day, this prisoner came in eye contact with this woman, and the woman said, "I'm being held without here, without a name," and gave the woman her name. The woman forgot the name, but after the war saw a picture of Mildred and said, "Yes, that's definitely the prisoner that I saw there." So that's how we know that she was being held there. I had wanted to film in that prison. It's not being operated anymore as a prison. And in June of 2011, I was there shooting, and the next month it was going to be converted into condos. So this would be my last chance to shoot. They were doing an art exhibit on, it was a bizarre art exhibit, I'll just leave it at that, about women being tortured that they had in each of the cells that you'd go through, and they didn't want us coming in filming and disrupting this art exhibit. I didn't know the reason at the time, and I couldn't find the prison. We were walking up and down the street, but it was like any street in Berlin. The facades were stores and things like that. And I went around to the drugstore and I asked if they knew where this prison was, and the lady gave me the exact address and where it was. And I could see down this doorway there was an alleyway, and I walked back there and the door was open and the exhibit was free. So I thought, well, that means I get to walk in, right? So I went in with a still camera and took photographs around the artwork so that you could see the bars and then the building, and then my videographer that I was working with actually walked into the courtyard, which was an open area right behind the facade of the building, and that's how we were able to get pictures of the prison, because, like I said, it wasn't going to be a prison much longer. The courthouse that you saw where the trials were held has also been converted into condos. The courtroom itself is a nightclub. So the building, this beautiful Prussian building, has been preserved. The owner of the building didn't want the hassle of a plaque being put on the building that this is what happened in the building, and so there's no plaque on the building itself, but there's a freestanding plaque out next to the sidewalk about what had happened in that building. The photo that you saw, there's a three shots of Mildred Harnack. It's a mugshot, the Gestapo mugshot. That's the last known photograph of her that we are aware of. You can see she has really dark hair in that photo. She was arrested in September. By February, her hair had turned completely white from the stress that she was going through. When we arrived in Berlin to do some of the shooting, we knew that on the night that she was delivered, so she was held in Charlottenburg prison and then taken to Plotzensee prison for the execution. And the night that she went there in February, it was a cold, rainy night. We knew that. We arrived from London, where we had done some interviews with the family. We were on the ground for less than 24 hours in London, got on a plane, flew to Berlin, got there in the afternoon. And I said, let's go to the prison right away and shoot some video. And we had been there about 15 minutes, and it started to rain. So we got the video of the rain, and it rained for about 15 minutes and stopped and never rained again the time that we were in Berlin. So this next clip that you're going to see is basically about Mildred's second trial, her death, and the legacy.
Thank you.
As a cold rain blanketed Berlin, a prison van delivered Mildred down a cobblestone street to Plötzensee prison, where the Nazi tools of death were housed. The prison chaplain, Harold Polschau, was a family friend.
He was deeply touched by her personality, by her confidence.
The pastor described how, at age 40, Mildred was so starved, so broken after 5 months of Nazi interrogations, she could no longer stand upright. He gave Mildred a Bible, and she read,
"And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love."
Pastor Polschau brought Mildred an orange he had smuggled in the prison along with a picture of her mother. Mildred remained strong until she saw this photo, her eyes filled with tears. Mildred kissed the picture again and again. On the back she wrote,
"The face of my mother expresses everything I want to say at this moment. This face was with me all through these last months."
The chaplain broke the news to Mildred. Arvid had been executed on December 22nd, her mother's birthday.
He told Mildred about Arvid's death and how he died and what were on his lips, and that he believed he prayed to the power of love.
Mildred remembers in her death cell. Arvid remembers in his death cell. Rowing their rowing boats, reciting Goethe and Whitman. They share this happiness to their very last moment on this planet. Maybe they still share it.
With hands cuffed behind her back, two guards led Mildred into a brick shed. A curtain was pulled back, revealing the guillotine. On February 16th, 1943, inside an execution room that looked more like a chapel, Mildred Fish-Harnack was strapped to a bench and guillotined at 6:57 p.m. The Nazis would note it took Mildred 7 seconds to die. The only American woman ever executed on the direct orders of Adolf Hitler. Her last words?
"Und ich habe Deutschland so geliebt."
And I have loved Germany so much. Exactly 3 months to the day after her execution, a Milwaukee Journal article announced Arvid's death. Mildred's fate? Still unknown. Through the help of a Vatican emissary, Mildred's family sent a message to Berlin.
"Precious little sister, the old home is waiting, and funds for your passage when possible."
After months of anxious waiting, a letter from an archbishop arrived confirming their worst fears. Mildred had been executed 7 months earlier. Following the defeat of Hitler, the Heath family returned to Berlin.
"Father had no idea what had happened to Mildred and Arvid. Father explained it all. My father suddenly waved his hand and walked out to the garden and wept. And my whole memory of my life with my parents, I can't think of times when we didn't talk about Mildred and Arvid. They were just our best friends."
But friends and family would have to defend the Harnack's honor, especially through a Cold War lens. In May 1945, Greta Kukov, the Harnack's friend and fellow resistance fighter, was freed from prison by Soviet troops. Greta and the Harnack family fought to bring Nazi prosecutor Manfred Roeder to justice for crimes against humanity.
The Americans treated Roeder in an interesting way. At first, they put a gun to his head and they asked him, "So how does it feel to be like that?" But once they asked him why he had killed these people, and he had said they were all communists, in the Cold War climate, they thought that he was their friend.
At Nuremberg, Germany, Nazis were put on trial. Manfred Roeder would go free, protected by the Americans who wanted his help tracking Soviet spies.
If you can imagine the reaction of people like Greta Kukov and Paul Harnack, who had such terrible loss. And then they're told that the Americans are protecting this man, this Nazi. They were angry. They were angry at the United States.
The CIA took the Nazis at their word and investigated surviving members of the resistance as communist spies.
The Americans had really dropped the ball. They were looking at people like Fall-Karnak and Greta Kukoff, who were in Berlin, and they made visits to them. They were trying to finger them.
All based on Gestapo reports that had no mention of assistance to the Americans. As a result, the lines between reality and fiction begin to blur. In 1947, the University of Wisconsin Alumni Magazine meant well when it published an article putting Mildred in the spotlight.
The Harnack story in the United States really broke in the UW Alumnus Magazine. It was very interesting. And so they found lots of good things and reasons why she should be recognized.
But as the Cold War heated up, a move to honor Mildred was halted because her pro-communist sympathies could not be ruled out. Wisconsin Senator Joe McCarthy and his hunt for communists may have been a factor. So instead of honoring Mildred, the university's inquiry triggered an FBI investigation.
The people had no idea at that time of the real story of the Red Orchestra in Berlin and what Mildred Hammer and Arnold Hammer really did. And at that time, it was seen as communist in Germany, in the United States, and also in the Soviet Union.
All I can tell you is Arvid Harnack was very wary of Stalin, totally. He did not trust him. He did not want anything to do with him.
Even so, the Soviets would posthumously award the Harnacks medals and enshrine them as communist heroes.
They retrofitted a lot of people like Greta Kukoff. They predated their communist membership cards. So they kind of retrofitted the Harnacks and the Schulze boys into being much better communists than they might have been, much more Stalinist than they might have been.
Part of the propaganda included putting Mildred and Arvid's pictures on a series of stamps honoring the resistance. Even though they were all dead, the stamps became part of a CIA top secret file. The Harnack family also learned the East German secret police engraved Arvid's image on a medal.
And they were abused in the so-called German Democratic Republic with this medal.
And used it as a reward for informants.
From the Ministry of State Security, they got Arvid's medal.
By 1976, an East Berlin high school is named after Mildred Harnack, the first school honoring an American in Eastern Europe. But in America, sentiment toward Mildred was slow to shift. The State Department in 1961 ruled out any recognition, explaining although Mildred was an American citizen, Mrs. Harnack's activities were not conducted on behalf of the U.S. government.
The Harnacks were killed twice. They were executed by the Nazis, and their characters were assassinated in the post-war period.
Those judgments all came during the height of the Cold War, before the fall of the Berlin Wall and communism.
There wasn't a lot of really factual information, documents, until really the wall came down. And we now then had access to what the East Germans knew.
And what the Americans knew.
When I got those files declassified, that we ever saw what had happened. There was rumor that there was a Gestapo final report, but nobody had seen it. Somehow the Gestapo final report ended up in the American National Archives for all those years.
That's when it came out. The Gestapo had exaggerated the facts. The communists had distorted the truth, and the Americans had sheltered Nazis while suppressing the story of the Harnack's help to the United States. In 2011, the CIA still refused to release all of its records in this case, and FBI files are still heavily redacted.
At this point, I want to share with you a couple of the documents that you just saw and some of them that were mentioned. I did make some copies, and we're going to pass them out if you could share them. There's probably one for every three or four people. But we're going to talk about those in just a minute. While they're passing those out now, I'll tell you about a couple of other things. What you just saw, a lot of people are shocked that Mildred was guillotined. They thought that went out in the Middle Ages. but there were actually 18 guillotines in operation during Nazi Germany times. She was an American citizen with an American passport yet. They think that maybe that's one of the reasons they didn't allow any family members to see her. She was suffering from tuberculosis. She was extremely stressed out from the interrogations. As I mentioned, her hair had turned completely white in the 5 or 6 months that she was imprisoned there. Hitler also had a saying, or the Nazis did, no myths, no remembrance, no martyrs. So when she was originally tried and given 6 years, that's one of the reasons Hitler said, absolutely not, we don't want anybody to know about this group, let alone have anybody survive that was a member of this group. That add insult to injury, when Mildred was executed, her body was immediately taken to the Anatomical Institute of Berlin. This part is not in the documentary. Her body was sent there, all female prisoners who were executed, their bodies were sent there for research. Dr. Hermann Stieb was doing research on the female reproductive organs and what stress did to women. And so she was immediately taken there for dissection. And Mildred's body was recognized. We're not certain how. He was on the same faculty as she was when she taught at Berlin University. We also know there was a family member who knew him. And so whether he was tipped off that her body may be coming through, and if you see it, would you please preserve it for the family? He did do that. He claims to have done that, cremated her ashes and left it in an urn, and gave it back to the Harnack family after the war. German experts in the resistance don't believe the story. They say the story only came out after the war when he tried to cover his Nazi war crimes. But like I said, the Harnack family believes the story. The remains that they were given are buried at Zehlendorf Cemetery, a very large cemetery in Berlin. She is the only member of the Red Orchestra, if those are her remains, whose remains were recovered. No other person who was executed, their remains have not been found. There was one theory that their bodies were dismembered and thrown in rivers around Berlin. There's another story that they were cremated and spread in basically an open field, a killing field is what they called it, in Berlin, but no other remains have been found. The documents that I just passed out, one of them is from the FBI. This is when I filed the Freedom of Information Act. I did 19 of these through the CIA, through the Army, through the FBI, to get information, and this is what they sent me. They can do this up to 70 or 75 years. This one, I think, is from 1948, so we have a few more years before they have to take the redaction off of this, supposedly. We'll see. I'm not necessarily actively working on this story anymore, but this is one document that I would like to see what it says. A lot of people ask me, what do you think it says? I have a feeling it shows that the Americans were on the wrong side after the war, that they believed this group was communist. They clearly were not. There were members who were definitely left-leaning. There were members who were communists. Mildred Harnack never had a communist card. She never joined the Communist Party. I could say that she was a Nazi before I could say she was a communist, because she did join the Nazi Party. She had to in order to keep her job. Arva joined in 1937 the Nazi Party at the very, basically the 11th hour. He would have lost his job had he not joined, but he figured he could do more harm by fighting them from within and joining the party than by not joining the party. So when people argue that, why should we honor this woman, she's a communist, well, I can say that A, you have no proof for that, and B, the Russians were our allies at that time. It wasn't, the Cold War hadn't happened yet. So looking back at that, we can talk about that document. The other thing, when I talk about Eric Larson's book and this one fact that she had witnessed her husband's execution, two bits of information that I know she didn't. One was from Pastor Polchow, the Lutheran minister who talked to her on the day of her execution. He broke the news to her, and he wrote about all of the prisoners that he had talked to over time, and he also was a Harnack family friend. He didn't know Mildred specifically, but Arvid's great uncle, Adolf von Harnack, was Germany's leading theologian. There was Dietrich Bonhoeffer. So there were these members of the clergy that this Pastor Polchow knew, and he knew the Harnack family. And he reiterated this story that he broke the news to Mildred the day of her execution, that Arvid had been executed, in fact, on her mother's birthday. And if you don't want to believe him, then you can believe this questionnaire, which was given to Mildred the night that she was taken for execution. When she entered Plattensee prison, she was given this questionnaire to answer. We were the first ones actually to translate it into English. And if you flip to question 20, the question is, are you single, married, with whom, and blah, blah, blah. And her answer was, it can be assumed that I am widowed. I haven't, however, received an official letter informing me of the death of my husband, who was supposed to be executed. So those are in her own words, and in her own handwriting, so we know for a fact she didn't obviously witness her husband's execution in December of that year. This would have been February 15th. But she also underlined the word divorced, which experts can't really explain why she did that, unless she didn't maybe understand the German word for divorce, meaning obviously she'd been separated from her husband for several months, and she just misunderstood that, or from the stress of what was going on in her life at that time, that she just underlined that. The other interesting thing in this document is we know that Arvid, several years earlier, had bought Mildred a boat ticket home. He said, go back to the United States. It's dangerous here. We know that if we're caught, we're going to be killed. I want you to go home. She refused. He tried several times. He had the Heath family, they're good friends. Donald Heath, the first secretary of the U.S. Embassy, had a conversation with her and said, go home. We will get you home. And she refused. She said, I have work to do here. My husband is here. I am not leaving Germany. When she was arrested, they asked, what do you have of value? And one of the things that she listed that was in her purse on that day that she was arrested was one contract ticket to the United States. She paid $127, and that ticket home was still in her purse on the day that she was arrested. And that, again, comes from her own words from the questionnaire that she was given the night that she entered the prison for execution. And the final document is this one here. Now, it was controversial that Mildred was executed because her crimes didn't live up to the standards for an execution at that time in Germany. The family can understand why Arvid was executed, but Mildred's was a little more gray as to why. And many people said it was because Hitler didn't want anybody surviving and talking about this. He didn't want any martyrs. But again, it was outside the legal realm of why she was being executed. And what's interesting about this document here is, if you look under the reason for execution, there's a question mark, which raises the doubt that the people who were executing her didn't know why she was being executed for that crime as well. German experts had never seen this document until I had showed it to them. They have no explanation for this. One theory was that these documents were made after the war, when they were going through the records of the prison and someone wrote it down and they just didn't know the reason or didn't have a reason given to them. But if you look at the date of when this document was made, February 16th, 1943, today's date. It was 70 years ago today that Mildred Fish-Harnack was executed. To add a little more insult to injury, the Harnack family was billed for every day that Mildred and Arvid were in prison. They were billed for their lodging and their food. Their house was given to the family of a German stormtrooper. It was bombed in 1944. The house no longer exists, the last known location where they lived. It was in central Berlin near the Japanese and the Italian embassies, which are obviously targets of ours at that time. And so the house no longer exists. And then the final thing that I mentioned was the Gestapo final report, this report right here, which was found in the U.S. National Archives in the 1990s. Anybody want to venture a guess how it got into the U.S. National Archives? When it was clear that Berlin was going to fall to the Russians and the Americans, Nazi leaders took files like this that they could use to barter with the Americans. They did not want to be caught by the Russians. They would rather have surrendered to the Americans. It's believed that Manfred Roeder, the prosecutor in the case, took this document to barter with the Americans to say, you know what, the communists are your real enemies, and I was prosecuting the communists during my time as a judge. And I can tell you where all these people are. I can give you their names and their addresses, and you'll be able to track them down. And the Americans were very interested in the Soviet spy apparatus at that time because they knew what was coming as well. Well, lo and behold, what Manfred Roeder didn't tell him is that most of the people mentioned here were dead. So the United States basically covered for him for 3 years, and when they went to put him on trial, he said, well, isn't that going to be embarrassing now? You guys have protected me for the past 3 years, I've provided you with information, and this isn't going to look good, and they let him go free. He died a free man. He was also elected to political office in West Germany. And Falk Harnack, Arvid's brother, never forgot or forgave Manfred Roeder for what he had done. And it said that he would call Manfred Roeder up in the middle of the night and remind him often of what he had done to his brother. But Manfred Roeder was going to never never was prosecuted for his crimes against humanity, which Greta Kukoff, the other UW student, the German scholar who had come here, really fought vigorously to bring him to trial, and the Americans said no. So the final thing, at least the clip of the documentary that I want to show, is a farewell letter from Arvid to Mildred. He knew after 3 months of interrogations and the trials were going to start that this may be the last time that he was going to see Mildred. So he wrote a farewell letter to her. And he wrote about their time in Madison. Most of the letter deals with these days that they spent in Madison, some of their happiest times. He talks about the university club and singing on the morning that they either got engaged, their first date, I don't remember exactly which one it was, but if you know the UW campus, the university club is at the bottom of Madison Hill, and that's where Arvid lived. So you'll see a shot of that. He talks about Picnic Point. He talks about State Street. This is his farewell letter to her, and he knew this was his last chance to get her this letter. And so this is the last clip then that we're going to look at from the National Documentary today.
Mildred Fish-Harnack will be remembered as a Milwaukee-born, University of Wisconsin grad who became a Nazi resistance fighter. She loved America, loved Germany, and loved her husband.
They shared their work, they shared their joys, they shared their sorrows. It was really this wonderful, wonderful love story.
And it showed. While in prison, Arvid wrote a farewell letter to Mildred, and his thoughts were on Wisconsin.
My most beloved heart, if I had the strength in these past months to be calm and composed within myself, if I face what is to come with calm composure, it is due most of all to the fact that I feel connected to the good and beautiful things in this world. As far as people are concerned, it was those closest to me, and especially you, who embody both of these things. Last night, I let my thoughts roam through many of the most beautiful moments of our marriage. The more I thought about it, the more there were. It was as if I was looking into a starry sky in which the number of stars grows constantly the closer one looks. Do you still remember Picnic Point when we got engaged? I sang with joy early in the morning in the club, and even earlier, our first serious conversation on State Street. This conversation became my guiding star, and has been so ever since. I have also thought regularly about you and all my loved ones at 8 o'clock at night. They are thinking about both of us at the very same time. Do it as well. Then one knows that the feeling of love in the world flows into each other. You are in my heart. You shall always be within. My dearest wish is that you are happy when you think of me. I am too when I think of you. Lots and lots of kisses. I am hugging you tight. Your A.
Wow, some elegant words from a guy who was an accountant who wasn't known to be real sympathetic to much of anything, but that is only part of Arvid's farewell letter to Mildred. We actually have the whole letter online. We just didn't have time to put it into the entire documentary, but you can read it online, and we also had actually the voice of Arvid, who was a German pastor at the University of Wisconsin, read the entire letter. And I think Uli Rosenhagen did a wonderful job in playing Arvid's character in this documentary. A lot of people ask, well, how did we know that was the letter? How did that survive? You know, he handed it to her at the trial. She was in prison and then executed. Where did the letter come from? The night before Mildred's execution, she had this letter on her body, and others, she did get a cellmate the last few weeks of her time in prison, because it's rumored that she tried to commit suicide. She swallowed a handful of pins, and the Nazis gave her a cellmate so that she wouldn't commit suicide. And at this woman, Gertrude Lichtenstein, was given the letter by Mildred, and Mildred said, if you survive this war, please return this letter to the Harnack family. On October 8th, 1952, so 10 years after the trial, The letter was returned to the Harnack family, and she wrote Mrs. Harnack this letter. I read in an article in the deed that Arvid Harnack's mother is still alive, and I obtained your address from the editorial office. I am able only now to send you a legacy of the dear deceased woman that is precious to both of you and me. Arvid's last letter to his wife Mildred. In December 1942, I was in protective custody at the police headquarters in Berlin-Charlottenburg, waiting for transfer to Ravensbrück concentration camp. By chance, was it really chance, I was put in a cell with Mildred. I was her cellmate and a good comrade of hers from around December 15, 1942 to January 15, 1943. In those 4 weeks, we became close friends, and when I had to go, Mildred gave me this letter from her husband asking me to look after it carefully. So that's how the letter ended up in the Harnack, with the Harnack family, and today the original resides at the German Resistance Memorial Center in Berlin. On what would have been Mildred's final day in prison as well, she gave up a book that she was reading, The History of the Ancient World, written by Michael Rastasev, a former University of Wisconsin professor. She gave the book to her prison guard and wrote, "To Mrs. Klang, in memory of February 16, 1943, in the room where you can still see the beautiful trees through the window." We also know that she was translating poetry in her prison cell that day as well, and that gets detailed more in the documentary. As far as some of the visuals that you just saw, there was a shot that you might remember of a woman swimming across the lake. Because this is such a sad story, I have to tell kind of a funny story to wrap this up with. But this was Kumalanka, which is on the outskirts of Berlin. It's called Crooked Lake. It's where the Heaths and the Harnacks would meet to transfer information. And so we were going there to do some filming. And we took a taxi, and I got out, and I could see the lake down the ways a little ways, maybe 100 yards away. And there were two paths, and we were trying to scout what we were going to shoot and how we were going to shoot it. And when I got out of the cab, and I was standing at the top of the hill, I looked down, and I could see a gentleman eating his lunch, and he didn't have a shirt on. I was from the back. I didn't think any big deal of it. And so my photographer went around one way, and I went around another way, and we met up at the lake, and I stopped and kind of looked at her. And there was a hill behind her.